Thank you for coming for tonight's talk. Before we start the talk, I would like to introduce Bhante to everybody. Professor Venerable Panaha Duwe Yasassi is a professor in Buddhist Civilization at the Department of Pali and Buddhist Studies, University of Sri Jaya Wadenapura, Sri Lanka. Bhante obtained his Bachelor of Arts Honours in Buddhist Civilization degree with a first class and PhD from the same university. Bhante has also successfully completed two Masters of Arts in Buddhist Studies degree from University of Kalaniya and Buddhist and Pali University of Sri Lanka. Bhante is the founder and director of International Buddhist Research Centre and co-secretary of Sri Lanka Association of Buddhist Studies. Bhante Yasassi served his knowledge sharing as a visiting lecturer in local and international universities such as Buddhist and Pali University of Sri Lanka, University of Kalaniya, and Buddhist and Pali College of Singapore. As a scholar in Buddhist studies, Bhante has authored several books and editions. Bhante has authored a number of index and refereed journal articles, research articles, and has presented research papers in national and international conferences. Currently, Bhante is conducting lectures, Dhamma talks, and public oration locally and internationally. Tonight, we have the privilege to invite Bhante to give a talk to us. The title of the talk is How to Overcome Anger. Bhante, please.
Okay. Thank you. It's okay. Say sadhu three times, please. Before starting today's Dhamma sharing, let us observe five precepts. So that observing five precepts, recite Namo Tassa Bhagavato three times. Buddhaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Dhammaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Sanghaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Dutiyampi Buddhaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Dutiyampi Dhammaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Dutiyampi Sanghaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Tatiyampi Buddhaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Tatiyampi Dhammaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Tatiyampi tatiyampi sanghaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Pānāti pātā virmani sikkhā padaṃ samādhiyāmi. Adinnā dānā virmani sikkhā padaṃ samādhiyāmi. Kāmesu micchācārā virmani sikkhā padaṃ samādhiyāmi. Musāvādā virmani sikkhā padaṃ samādhiyāmi. Surāmeraya majjapamā dattānā virmani sikkhā padaṃ samādhiyāmi. Se sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Let us start to establish the mindfulness. Just keep your body straight. Close your eyes. Leave all the unwholesome thoughts that comes to your mind. Don't allow any unwholesome thoughts to enter your mind. Just send them away. Try to relax your mind. Relax. 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 Just pay attention to mindfulness on your head, forehead, eyes, nose, back, stomach, thighs and your feet. Just try to establish mindfulness in breathing. Breathe out. Breathe in, keep mindful in breathing, breathe out, keep mindfulness whether you are taking a breathe in. Try to relax your mind. Relax your body. Let all the unwholesome feelings go away. Relax. Relax. Relax your mind. Pay concentration yourself. Just remind, may I be well and happy. May I refrain from unwholesome thoughts. May I refrain from all the diseases. May I be free from cankers. Establish mindfulness on yourself. Extend your loving kindness to your neighbor. May my parents be well and happy. May my parents be well and happy. May my parents be well and happy. Mindfully extend loving kindness to your family members. May my family members be well and happy. May my family members be well and happy. May my family members be well and happy. Be mindful on breathing. Breathe out. Breathe in. Breathe out. Be mindful on the moving of your mind. Be mindful on feelings. May all the divine beings, all the departed ones, all those who are living in the universe, may they be well and happy. May all the divine beings, departed ones, all those who are living in the universe, extend your loving kindness towards them. May they be well and happy. May they be well and happy. try to take your mind into one-pointedness. Again, try to establish mindfulness from your feet to head. Don't let unwholesome thoughts to come to your mind. Relax your head. Relax your eyes. Relax your nose. Relax your mouth. Relax your ears. Relax your body. Relax your feet. Okay, say sadhu 3 times. Let us move on to the Dhamma sharing. Before that, we will invite the deities, divine beings, to come here to listen Dhamma. Samanta chakravalesu atra gacchantu devata saddhang mang muni rajas sunantu sagg mokkadang Dhamma savana kalo ayang badanta. Dhamma savana kalo ayang badanta. Dhamma savana kalo ayang badanta. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa Akkocchimang avadimang ajinimang ahasime Yetang na upanaihanti virang te supasammatiti. He abused me. He struck at me. He overcame me. He robbed me. Those who bear not ill will towards this, their hatred is surely appeased. That is one of the teachings found in Dhammapada, which we are talking, one of the most related stanzas found in Dhammapada related to today's talk. Today's Dhamma sharing is on how to overcome anger. This is one of the most familiar topic for all of us. You may remind yourselves whether I get angry, how much I get angry. And then, what are the causes that led to get angry? When you get angry, what are the causes? In the situations like getting angry, what was your reaction? And what are the strategies that you used in overcoming angry in situations that you had angry minded? So these are the things that we have to discuss in today's Dhamma sharing. So based on the how to overcome angry, we will be talking about the most significant points related to anger management. As you know, we have different kinds of feelings. Some of those feelings we call positive feelings, and some of them are negative. So, as we see love, affection, or the kindness, and there are so many positive feelings that we are thinking on others, oneself and the others. Simultaneously, there are certain unwholesome feelings that arises in our mind. Most probably we get angry, we feel greediness or craving, and also we feel the lustful thoughts, proud, and there are so many negative feelings that arises in our mind. So basically, anger is a kind of negative feeling that arises in our mind. Therefore, so that maintaining our mind free from anger, there should be a well aware and well understanding on these things. Therefore, in today's Dhamma sharing, we will be talking about how to overcome anger. So I have given few, this is one of the reactions when we are affecting to anger. When we have anger, ill will in our mind, mind is corrupted, and its reaction would be arise in physical conflicts. Once you had got angry, you may remind there may be some incidents in your life. How you reacted to anger. Okay? There may be some past experiences that you have gained. So the physical conflicts is one of the reactions, results of the anger. Sometimes we can see how people are facing much difficulties or the facing so many issues, problems, and imprisonment due to the anger and its reactions, right? Then another way that we release anger is by using our words. Basically, when we get angry, we try to release angry through our words, through our mouth, right? Arrogantly we try to talk with some people, always try to fight with some people without having controlled one's anger, and then so many people are affected and they are becoming affected to the others' behavior like this. On the other hand, when experiencing anger, we ourselves thinking much by considering the reactions we have done. So it is a kind of way of polluting our mind, right? So therefore, all these are considered bad experiences, immoral experiences, as well as they are considered the experiences which are not beneficial for oneself and the others, right? Therefore, why overcoming anger is important, that is because of the we can control our physical body, and also we can control our words as well as our mind by controlling and overcoming anger. Therefore, it is very important to overcome anger so that maintaining a very peaceful, harmonious, happy and comfortable life. Once I remember that there was a person who are dear to me who gets quick angry. Once he was driving his car, when another vehicle comes in front, or when another vehicle tries to pass him, at that time he quickly get angry, and within inside the car he always try to blame him. So if we traveling together around 5 to 10 kilometers, if count the harsh and the arrogant words he has uttered, maybe over 100. That is how people quickly get angry and they try to do something like that. So what is the bad, harmful thing is, he always make his mind corrupted with there is no peace, harmony, comfort in their mind because of the angry minded or because of the anger. So therefore, it is very important to control and overcome anger according to the Buddhism as well as according to so that maintaining a very peaceful life. As a preamble, I would like to draw your attention on today's world. Nowadays, we can see so many problems that has been originated in the world are due to anger in human minds. Now we can see interpersonal conflicts, intrapersonal conflicts, intergroup conflicts, intragroup conflicts throughout the world. There are so many issues like that, right? So how they had originated? So sometimes we call them conflict, tension, turmoil, and we can use so many words to denote the nature, how people are reacting to the anger. And they can happen based on gender sometimes, right? There are certain issues and origin of anger based on gender or ethnicity. Most of the world wars, we can see they have originated based on the ethnicity. And race, religion, politics, ecology, and another most important thing is ideology. Based on the ideology, all these are rooted by the anger. When taking it into nutshell, all these are rooted in the based on the anger. Apart from that, there are so many things like, you know, we have to identify what are the and why anger harmful. Even today, you know, Western medical sciences, scientists have identified that anger is a major threat to physical body, not only the mental mental health of the individual, but also physical health of the individual. According to the medical science, they have investigated that uncontrolled anger results in release of various hormones and neurotransmitters. They have done research, they have, you know, made investigations, and they have come to conclusions that due to the uncontrolled anger, it has resulted even our hormones and neurotransmitters, according to their researches. Then what happened when hormones and neurotransmitters, when they release in based on the anger, it can result to affect different diseases such as blood pressure, cardiac muscles contracts, and gastric secretions increase, and some other so many things have been identified. So basically, when the mind is not relaxed, we can clearly identify that our blood pressure rises, right? Then most probably, research has been done based on the people who passed away with stroke. According to the result of that research, they have identified more than 80% of those who passed away on the stroke, they had faced that situation when they were in anger minded. You can see how anger is how much is it affect to our physical body. On the other hand, the illnesses like hypertension, peptic ulcer, stroke, and most of the other diseases has been caused to increase the death rate according to the anger. So that has scientifically proven by the modern medical sciences. Therefore, so the maintaining peace, harmony, why that is important? Because of this reason, right? It means that anger can be considered a health issue, health problem, which causes one's life to destruction of the one's life because of these reasons. On the other hand, psychologically what happens when people are affecting anger, uncontrolled anger poisons the mind and it may cause mental disorders such as depression and stress. Most probably, these are the two main psychological diseases that most of the people are affecting, right? Depression and stress. Based on that, there are so many psychological problems comes into existence. According to Western psychology, they have identified so many psychological issues. According to them, depression and stress are considered the two pillars which are related to or the influence to arise so many psychological issues accordingly. So they are led by the uncontrolled anger according to the Western psychology. On the other hand, based on that, what I wanted to emphasize here is uncontrolled anger is a kind of enemy, unseen enemy that we are creating in our mind by ourselves, right? It means we are calling our death because of our anger. For some extent, it will not happen right now, but it will reach the death to our life because of the uncontrolled anger. That is why this anger, how to control anger and overcoming anger is very important to study and to practice different strategies so that overcoming anger. In Pali tradition, we have different terms used with regard to anger in Pali tradition. So, one who is searching much about the anger and its related, the related things in Pali tradition, Pali literature, we can have different terms that can be identified. You know, the most prominent one is krodha. You know the krodha, right? Krodha. Krodha means anger. And vera, hatred. It is another, the same word, but it gives the different context. Virodha, against. Why we against to someone else or something else? That is because of the anger. Dosa, aversion or hate. Then patigha means strong anger. The slight anger is called kodha. Patigha is strong anger. That is something dangerous, right? Then vyapada, anger, aversion, ill will and hatred. Agatha means hatred, annoyance and resentment. Kopa is another term. Rosa, palasa, upanaha. All these are used in Pali canonical text so that emphasizing the nature of anger. So what I wanted to say is why this number of, so many words have been used by the Buddha to denote anger. Because in different places in Pali tradition, Pali literature, Buddha has used different levels of anger so that showing the nature of the anger, used different terminologies like this. They are some kind of synonyms but uses in different context, right? When the Buddha wanted to show the simple status of anger, normally use koda. But when it comes to medium level, higher than that, uses the term vera, right? And also when it is increased, some higher status, it uses the term patigha. Again, when it's come to its, you know, highest level, vyapada is used, right? So what you have to think is, here there are some stages of anger, right? Sometimes we just quickly get anger and then it ceases, right? Within few minutes. In Western psychology says, when you get angry, what will you do? They says that you have to count from 1 to 10 and 10 to 1 again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 10, 9, 8, something like that, okay, up to 1. Then, doing sequence like that, what will happen? Just anger getting low. What is the thing behind that? It doesn't reduce our mind, but our mind goes to another direction, right? Then we try to maintain mindfulness, right? For what? So that counting up and down. Counting up and down. Down and up. Then we pay attention to another aspect and then we just forget and try to subdue the reason for the anger, right? Then we come to the real right position after few minutes. That is some strategies. I mean that is the nature of the general phase of the anger. But there are some other issues like that. Some people, when they get angry, they try to maintain it for a long time. Right? No ceases. Sometimes, you know, even I have one experience that there was a family in around our monastery, and that mother cannot see her daughter. Whenever she sees her daughter, she get quick angry. When searching what is the reason, it is one of very slight offense that daughter has done, using few words. Based on that, it has been created, implanted on the mind, and just continue it, right? Sometimes there are some people like that. They try to maintain alone time. That is something that get corrupted our mind, and it is the second level. And sometimes there are certain characters who are maintaining the anger, not only this life, but also during the sansaric life, they follow the anger and they do like that, right? There are some Jataka stories where we can found. One of the most prominent character is Devadatta, right? Devadatta's character, we know that very well. He had anger on the Buddha, and during the sansaric existence, wherever and whenever he was born, he tried to make different, you know, aversions against the Buddha. So many things like that. So that is how the anger in different phases, right? Normally, before the arahantship, it is general, normal to get anger, right? It's okay. Sometimes we have. Only the arahants and the higher status, when they are coming, they don't get angry. But normally, as the people who are attached to this world, we are facing anger and some other things, right? But the thing is, how much level we are maintaining, that is most important. So that we should know the different levels of the anger, so that understanding it. And according to Buddhism, those, you know, there are three unwholesome roots, right? Very prominent. What are they? Raga, dosa, and moha. Raga means the lust. Dosa means hatred. Moha, delusion, right? These are the three main causes for the unwholesome, for doing unwholesome deeds. Raga, dosa, moha. We do all the unwholesome deeds because of these three, right? There is no anyone else because of raga, dosa, and moha. You know, if we consider that these are three pillars of a building, right? The dosa is considered one of the pillars which holds the half of the heavy of the building, right? It means that in Buddhism, it is considered dosa or hate. Anger is considered one of the three causes of unwholesome akusala. Similarly, it is considered as one of the five hindrances, right? Why we are sojourning this samsara? Because of five hindrances. Our samsaric or the emancipation is covered by five hindrances. So, out of them, anger, vyapada is considered one of the five hindrances. Right, that is why Buddha always tried to emphasize why we should overcome anger. That is one of the reason. Because until overcoming anger, we cannot attain enlightenment or emancipation. On the other hand, as we know, there are 10 fetters, dasa sangyojana. You know the word sangyojana, right? Fetters. Why they call fetters? They always attached us to the samsaric existence. While maintaining fetters, we cannot attain enlightenment. So therefore, vyapada is considered one of the fetters out of 10 fetters accordingly. And satta anusaya dhamma, patiga, or strong anger against someone is one of 7 inclinations according to Buddhism, satta anusaya dhamma. So why these kinds of different interpretations have been given to the anger? The reason, it is considered one of the main reason to cover the path of emancipation, path of liberation, okay, path of Nibbana. That is why Buddha has given much attention to anger, because most probably our mind is corrupted by the anger. And when mind is corrupted by the anger, so many unwholesome thoughts are coming inside, and they try to haunt within the mind, and they do not allow us to be free from such mental, you know, unwholesome thoughts. Once Buddha had given one example to that. You know, there are certain trees, right? So there are certain trees which are corrupted, or which are not, you know, like they are having certain creepers within the tree. When it goes here and there, what happens? the value of the tree is getting low. On the other hand, another example, Buddha says, when you know a paddy field is growing properly, certain diseases are arising from the paddy itself. Then what happened? Its harvest is getting low, right? Growing controls and its harvest reduces. In the same way, Buddha said, when our mind is polluted by the anger, we cannot go forward in the samsaric existence. Therefore, it has to be identified. According to Buddhism, as you all know, mind is forerunner to all, right? Mind is forerunner to all. You can maintain, manage your physical body easily. You can control your mouth also, right? Words easily. But most difficult thing is to manage our, control our mind. Why? Always, mind takes external objectives from outside. According to Buddhism, there are five ways that we gain, grasp external objectives, right? What are they? From eyes, we see some pictures or forms. Then we made some kind of consciousness, eye consciousness. Then we try to give certain judgments over those things we get. And then, because of that, we try to corrupt our mind. In the same way, two eyes, noses, and also the ears, tongue and body. Based on those four ways, we get external objectives to our mind. And then, by holding those objectives, we try to treat them. As a result, mind is getting corrupted. Then what happened? Then mind gives certain commands to your body. You are not your hands and legs, your body is very silent. Until your mind is being free, right? When the mind temptation going up, what happens? Then automatically you try to react on them, and then the silent body comes to forward and try to do something, like, you know, the fighting, making conflicts and so many things like that, okay? And also try to talk some harsh words, rough words and something like that. So that is why Buddha said, this mind, controlling mind is very important, and what mind is corrupted should be controlled first, before controlling one's body or whatever the physical things that we are talking about, your mouth or whatever. So then, if the mind is corrupted by the major force for corrupting mind is anger, we have to address for that, not keeping your hands to be bound together, right? It cannot happen like that. So that is very important point. Therefore, Buddha said like that. So if our mind is corrupted and with unwholesome thoughts, our action also would be the same. If the mind is pleasant, our body would be pleasant. What we are doing would be pleasant. Therefore, that is very important, so that understanding. Another thing is that, you know, the Mara. Mara means evil one, right? He always tried to corrupt our mind and body. What he does is, he always tried to corrupt our mind by showing different things, different objectives from the five senses, like what we were talking, our eyes, nose, mouth, tongue and body, right? Mara always try to do that corrupt. Once I remember, there is a very interesting story that there was a fox in a forest. In the meanwhile, there was a tortoise who was wandering in the same forest. Once the tortoise was wandering by searching of food in the evening near a bank of a river, on the same way, the fox was also going on arms round. Then what happened when the tortoise was going on arms round? It was followed by the fox, and fox thought that it is a good food for me. By thinking that, fox reaches the tortoise. When it reaches, tortoise understood that it has a kind of danger because of the fox is following him. Then what he did was he tried to hide all the five parts of his body within the shell, right? He had a very good protective element, very strong enough, right? And whenever he faces any kind of dangerous situation, he tried to hide them inside the cell. Then fox came and fox tried to take even one part of the body out, could not. And fox was so tired, and finally it decided that it is useless in struggling with this tortoise, and thinking that it went away by searching of another food. Then by taking this example into consideration, Buddha mentioned that Mara looks like the fox, and we are equal to the tortoise, right? Then Mara always tried for us to persuade us to do bad things from our five faculties, just as the four legs and the head of the tortoise, you know, Mara always persuade us to do bad things. Then when we are controlled our five senses, Mara don't have any opportunity to do something unwholesome from ourselves. By taking that example, Buddha said, therefore, one should try to control one's mind. That is the most important thing. When the mind is corrupted with anger, ill will, or whatever the wrong or the unwholesome thoughts, automatically our body would be corrupted. Right? That is the most important point. Then why we get angry? Now I'll try to analyze the reasons for getting angry. You may remind, there may be some experiences, right? Can raise hands those who get angry? Yeah, good. That's good. Normally we all have in different levels, right? As I mentioned earlier. If someone say, I don't get angry, that is false speech. that never happens like that, okay? So why we get angry? According to, you know, there is a very significant discourse called Agahata Vattu Sutta, one of the discourses. In Agahata Vattu Sutta mentions, there are 10 ways of getting angry. That is, you know, these 10 ways include everything. That why you get angry, right? Just try to analyze the reason. The Buddha says, always Buddha points out, if you search, if you find a solution, you have to go to the root. That is what the Four Noble Truths says, right? Without going to root, you cannot overcome or the find solution to anything or any problem. That is why when you are going to the doctor, what does the doctor do? Just give an injection first? No. Give a portion of medicine for you to drink? No. What does he do? He tried to investigate, right? Having investigated, having identified the reason for the disease, then start treatments. Same strategy is given by the Buddha in Four Noble Truths. So therefore, this analytically understanding on the reasons for causing anger is very important. In Agathavattu Sutta, there are 10 points. Look at the number one. Thinking he has done me harm. When you are having anger on someone else, you think that he has done me harm. Right? By thinking that, try to anger over him or her. Look at the second one. He is doing me harm. Earlier one was past, right? By maintaining the past consciousness, we try to continue with anger. And now he is doing me harm. By considering someone's behavior, think like that. And third one, he is going to do me harm. It is something that can be happened in the future. We imagine that, right? Even in the future, he will do harmful things for me. By thinking, they try to continue anger. They means you and myself, right? Then look at the fourth one. He has done harm to people who are dear and pleasing to me. Now we extend that beyond oneself and thinking that he has done harm for my husband, my wife, my children, my parents, my family members, my neighbors, my country people or whoever, right? Just try to think like that, clinging. Then he is doing harm to people who are dear and pleasing to me. Doing harm, that is something we practice in the present. And sixth one says, he is going to do harm to people who are dear and pleasing to me. That is also the future. They are thinking like that. Then seventh one, he has aided people who are not dear or pleasing to me. That is how we think and get anger, right? He has aided people who are not dear or pleasing to me. When we have some enemies or someone else who are not dear to me, we try to think that we makes anger because of them. He is aiding people who are not dear or pleasing to me. He is going to aid people who are not dear or pleasing to me. And the tenth one, getting angry at useless things. So these are the 7-10 ways of causing anger. Now just try to analyze whether we are making anger, whether we take anger on proper time. Just try to forget what has done in the past, right? Why? Past has already gone. Sometimes we try to maintain some kind of inclinations which happened in the past. Maybe 1 year ago, 2-3 years ago, or 10 or 15 years ago, people try to maintain anger in that way, right? Thinking on past. If you are able to conscious, keep mindful only on the present, we can overcome, we can neglect what happens in the past. Then how many causes going away? Three, right? For here, the past, the fourth one, again past, and the seventh one, again past. So everything, that three causes can be eliminated, neglected, if we try to maintain mindfulness on present. The reason why Buddha said, Atitang nanusochanti nappajappanti nagatang, the past has already gone. There is no use of lamenting over the things happened in the past, right? We are doing something like, you know, we are memorizing, remembering, we are always trying to introspect what happened in the past, which has already passed. And therefore Buddha said, we should not do like that. It looks like a cow. Normally, you know, when a cow eats grass, sometimes he put them away and again eat them, right? That is the nature of the cow. In the same way, we are also doing like that. It is a kind of recycling. Redoing the thing, same thing, right? Then just do like that. That is not a good way of maintaining our mindset. Secondly, look at the third one. Something to be happened in the future, right? Not yet come, but we are trying to maintain that consciousness. Something to be happened in the future. Then we think of oneself. We think of others who are dear to us. Something can happen in the future for my dearest people, right? Then we try to maintain anger. And also try to think that someone is going to aid people who are not dear or pleasing to me. Something, it is also from the future. So by considering oneself, dearest and nearest ones, and one's enemies, like those who are against oneself, by thinking on them in future, we try to maintain anger. The Buddha said, we should not think over the future. Why? Future has not come yet. It is useless of thinking over the future in that way. Then Buddha said, you have to maintain only the present moment. That is the present moment means what we are, where we are living right now. Then what happened? You can neglect past 3 points, future 3 points, and the 10th one, getting angry at useless things, right? Sometimes we do like that. It is not the proper time to get angry, but we automatically try to get angry by considering very slight things, like, you know, something happens. Sometimes there are certain people, you know, I have one experience that there was a person, when the dog barked, right, at the home, he get angry. I asked, who looked after this dog? He said, I myself. Then I asked, why you are getting angry if you are looking after that dog? That is something useless, right? But we do like that. We are the people who are responsible for those things, but we get angry in that way. Useless things, like most probably when analyzing, just try to analyze. Every day when you get angry, just try to point out the reasons and then try to analyze like this. Then most probably 99.9 reasons can be neglected because of this, according to the Buddha's teachings. Most probably, it means that we get angry most probably in useless things. Useless, something happens in the past or the future by considering something not important, useful, right? So this understanding is very important. Why? If we are not having clear aware on this, we are still getting angry and we try to react on that point. So then that is very important. On the other hand, Buddha said, there is a Magandhya Sutta is another one of the discourses. Buddha says, why people are attached to the getting angry and they are attaching to the conflicts. Buddha says, sanyancha dittincha ye aggahesung te gattayanta vicharanti loke. Because of the two things, perceptions and views. Perceptions means one's own experiences, right? There are certain people who don't want to get change. Even though they know that what is the one's own perception is wrong, they don't want to accept that. They don't want to change that because of the proud or whatever the bad nature behavior they have. Right? We normally say that there are certain people, by showing the sun, he says, this is the moon. Then what we have to do? We have to accept. Definitely know that it is sun, right? But don't try to change the mindset. Most probably, people get angry and people are persuaded to conflicts based on that perceptions, right? They think that one's perfection is the right. And also, ditti means views. One's view is considered as the perfect while neglecting, rejecting all other views, right? So Buddha said these are the two reasons for that. So they are completely against and something useless. Then Buddha has clearly emphasized the way that the reasons for the origin of the anger and conflicts. You can see here, at the beginning here, names and forms, right? Why we are getting angry and why we are getting to conflicts? Because of the names and forms. Names means some kind of, you know, the internal qualities like feelings, perceptions, right? Expositions, consciousness, like that. And the form means the rupa, right? Physical body, one something appearance, outer appearance. So based on that, we try to make certain contacts with them. Right? Passa. Rupa Vedana here. Then passa means the contacts, attachment. Then when we are attaching with those names and forms, what will happen? We create feelings of pleasure and pain, or pleasant and unpleasant, right? You suppose that when you see something from your eye, that is the form, then you touch them and you create a consciousness, eye consciousness. Then you take it into inside your mind, then you try to give a judgment whether that feeling is pleasure or pain, or pleasant or unpleasant, right? then if they are identified as pleasure or pleasant, we make desire to them, attach to them. Right? We make desire to them. When desire arises in mind, what happens? It leads to the greed or craving. We are very fascinated to that attachment, right? Then we are internalizing that idea or the whatever the feeling we had. Then what happened when we are attaching to that, then that is the thing what is dear, right? We think that is dear to me. And then based on that, trying to quarrel and disputes with others. When something, you know, someone against that, we try to fight with someone else, right? As instance, you suppose that you are attached to someone else, right? As your girlfriend or boyfriend. When someone reaches to him or her, what will happen? You try to fight with them, right? That is the way that the sequence of creating conflicts with the anger mind, according to the Buddha's teachings. So that is what Buddha said, we have to identify that. So in many places Buddha said, there is no crime than the anger. There is no crime than the anger. Natthi dosa samo kali. Why it is said like that? Because we are committed crimes, whether they are light or offensive, right? Whatever the nature of the crimes, we are doing them because of the anger, according to the Buddha's teachings. Further, he has mentioned, hatred burns oneself and others, right? When your mind is, you know, surrounded by the anger or hatred, it burns yourself and others. Just as, you know, putting fire into one's own mouth. That is the simile given by the Buddha. You suppose that if you put the fire inside your mouth, what kind of painful feeling you will have. In the same way, when we are living with hatred or, you know, hatred mind, we burn ourselves within. Not only that, because of our reactions, others are also burns in that way. Then Buddha said, just as keeping a snake on one's body, right? It is such a very great and grave, you know, the experience, according to the Buddha's teachings. Then further, Buddha has mentioned, what are the benefits? Why we need to overcome anger? Once there was a householder known as Subha, who came to the Buddha, who raised a question in front of the Buddha and asked, what are the reasons for the diversity among the humans? Some of them are very rich, while others are poor. Even in our society, we can see, right? There are certain diverse stratification. And some of them are very beautiful, pretty, and handsome, while others are ugly, not very, you know, pleasant. Buddha, there are so many questions raised. Out of them, the most important thing is that related to anger, Buddha said, by replying to that householder, Buddha said, why people are being born very pleasant and beautiful, pretty or handsome, the reason is not bearing hatred, right? If they don't get angry, automatically we practice loving kindness, right? Loving kindness is the opposite of angry and hatred. Those who practice loving kindness, Buddha said, they will be born pleasant, right? No need to go to, you know, the beauticians as well. Normally we are wasting much money, right, to that, to beautify ourselves. No need to go there. What we have to do is just try to avoid anger, ill will, hatred, or whatever like that, the feelings like that, and then try to cultivate loving kindness. Opposite to anger, when cultivating that, people would be born as very pleasant, like that. You can see, right? Go in front of the mirror. How you are beautiful, how you are pretty, how you are handsome, right? Just remind that when you look in at yourselves, remind that I have done in my previous life, I have practiced loving kindness. That is why I am here right now. Among those in the other people, right? Like, you know, the opposite of that. So the Buddha said, therefore, that is very important to practice in that way. On the other hand, there are some other ways, like, you know, the loving kindness. This is something very important, right? We can automatically, this is very simple thing that we can practice so that overcoming anger. Anger is opposite to the, sorry, loving kindness is opposite mindset to anger, right? Therefore, when we neglect anger, ill will, hatred, if we are able to practice loving kindness properly, that is very important. You see how it has to be practiced from oneself, right? At the beginning of, Dhamma sharing, we practice mindfulness for some times. Then we started by oneself. Those who are not able to love to oneself cannot never extend their loving kindness to other, right? If you don't love yourselves, you cannot do that. Some people think that I don't love me, but I love others. Cannot happen. Right? Because we should practice loving kindness from oneself. And then should try to extend that to one's own relatives, like, you know, most dearest and nearest people. And then should extend up to the universe. Right? That is the way Buddha mentioned, the way of extending loving kindness. So loving kindness is not something saying that may I be free from calamities, suffering, so the may I be well and happy. That is not something like incantations, right? So that is what you have to inculcate in your mind. And then it will automatically create you, make your mind peace, happy and comfort, according to the Buddha's teachings. Once it is mentioned Buddha's teachings, even if you are cut off by bandits using a two-handed saw, you should not have ill will towards them and should continue to feel care for their well-being while maintaining an attitude of loving kindness and lack of inner hatred. That is how the bodhisattvas, the one who practices the perfections, how they practice loving kindness, right? So in that way, we can do like that. And also through the great compassion, we can overcome anger. That is related to loving kindness. Then Buddha said, therefore, what we have to do is, we always try to manage our mind first, and then if we are able to control our mind, we can have a very happy comfort and also very, you know, joyful life within this life and hereafter. So most probably we are having ourselves, we are making ourselves very corrupted our mind. Then we are burning ourselves. And then that's its results would be gain this life and hereafter in negative way. The Buddha said, you are the savior of yourself. No one can save you. No one can liberate you. No one can fetch you to the heaven or hell. No one can give you the emancipation, right? So therefore, you have to do yourselves. You are the responsible. No God can do that, according to Buddha's teachings. At least, the Buddha could not deliver or the release his, you know, cousin brother Devadatta from the hell. That is the Buddha's teachings and nature, right? Therefore, we always should try to be mindful on those things. The Buddha says that, for not by hatred do hatreds cease at any time in this place. They only cease with non-hatred. This truth is surely eternal. Because, you know, hatred never overcome by hatred. Hatred can overcome only by loving kindness. Right? That is the eternal truth. So therefore we always should try to inculcate positive, you know, aspects like that. Then we can be a positive thinker. You see, the nature of the positive thinker. My students who studied in MA program, they know about all these things, right? I have taught them about positive thinking development and so many management concepts in that way. You know, nothing is impossible, right? Sometimes we think that it is difficult to manage my mind. I cannot overcome the anger, even though I tried so many times, right? Something like that, we try to say different words in different situations in that way. But what we have to think is nothing is impossible. We can do that if we are positive thinkers. So the nature of the positive thinker is he sees the invisible which cannot be seen by all others, right? He feels the intangible. He achieves the impossible. The third one, these three should be taken into consideration again and again. Then we can transform our mind into the correct way, right path. Until that transformation occurred in your mind, you can never overcome anger or whatever the defilements you have inculcated in your mind, right? Then try to do like that practice in that way. Just neglect all the unnecessary reasons for causes for rising anger. And then just try to inculcate loving kindness against that. Then whenever the Buddha, someone approached to the Buddha to obtain the objectives for meditation, Buddha considered the nature of the characteristics he has, right? Whether he has what is called the hatred character. The human are diverse, right? The way of their mindset and the way they are thinking is completely differ from each other. By considering that, if the person is in hatred or the such kind of temptation, the meditation the given by the Buddha was loving kindness. No, any other meditation cannot address to that temptation of the mind. So that is scientifically how Buddha did, right? The same way we have to manage our mindset in that way so that overcoming anger. So I think we are at the end of the today's sharing. Just remind on those things, right, which are very beneficial for you this life. Most probably, we have been maintaining some, you know, corrupted thoughts in our mind. We are burning ourselves. We are thinking much and more. We are lamenting over them. And we are always, we are in disappointed because of our thought patterns, right? Then what we have to do is always should try to transform negative ideas, negative thoughts, negative mentality into positive way. Then you can live happy, comfort and very peaceful manner, coexistence in the society. Okay, let's move into the questions and answers. Yes, sir. Any questions?
Okay, due to time constraint, I think we will give one or two questions. Anyone want to ask any question?
You know, Buddha said, Kalena Dhamma Sakaccha Etang Mangala Muttamang, right? You know, Dhamma discussion is an auspicious thing, right? So don't think much about the time. Normally we use time so many times for other things, but every day we cannot do like that. One or two questions we can give time for anyone else. No question means you did not understand anything. For my understanding with my students. Sorry?
Why will we get ugly if we never change on our next birth?
What, baby, what is your question? Please pardon again. Why we get angry, you said, right?
Why on our next birth we will get ugly if we never change?
What is the question?
Bhante is asking why in our next birth we will get ugly if we never change.
Oh, wow. Thank you so much for asking such a very nice and very good question, right? So the thing is that according to Buddhism, everything occurred according to the cause and effect theory, right? That is called causality, dependent origination. So the cause and effect theory, what we reap, you know, what we sow, the same result would be gained as the harvest, right? In the same way, when, the sansaric existence, when we practice the good qualities, that doesn't end with the death. Death is a temporary, temporary, something happens temporarily in the society, in our sansaric journey. Then we bring them to the next life also, right? That is how Buddha practiced perfections throughout the sansaric existence. In the same way, you suppose that when we are at the deathbed, right, about to die, passed away, in such situations, if we feel like, if we reminded and if we had the conscious of hatred as the final consciousness, final thought moments, right, definitely we will be born in lower status by being ugly. That is how dependent origination, based on that, how it happens. So even though we don't like, we cannot overcome that because of the because of the things that we have cultivated accordingly. Therefore, even in sansaric existence, there are so many places I have no time to explain in, you know, Vimanavattu Pali. There are so many examples, like, you know, when while practicing loving kindness, how people were born as very divine places, status, with very beautiful, you know, the very pretty divinities like that. There are so many things. So, baby, thank you so much for raising such a very wonderful question in front of very, you know, so many, like the big people. She raised the best, today's star. Yeah. Yes.
Bhante, thank you very much for this very insightful talk. I would like to ask you a question, please, especially about the causes of arising conflicts. And as you mentioned, don't change the mindset if people have a wrong perception or wrong view. What if this person is someone who is very close to you and you know that the perception and the wrong view will harm themselves and the others? How can we help them?
You are asking about this, right? Yeah. The thing is that, you know, the one is called, according to the Buddha's teachings, why we are trying to quarrel with others. Only these two causes, two reasons. Either perception holding certain perfections on oneself or others, or holding an extreme view. Maybe it is your religion, race, it can be your gender, or the whatever the reason, right? Whatever the reason, you are holding a view. So the nature of the, you know, conditioned people like us, we are always trying to maintain one's own view rather than respecting others, right? That is the nature. So when we are having in that way, when we attach to that way, the thought patterns, then automatically that would be contradictory idea with others, right? Because we are single in such a situation, because everyone knows that what I am thinking is wrong, but I still try to emphasize my own idea, then what will happen? Others may arise against me, right? Since they really know about the what is right and what is wrong. In that way, the Buddha says, the holding these perceptions and the views in that, those are the main reasons for causing the conflicts and some, you know, anger minds and some other things like that. So what we have to do is, someone can think that it is not the reason, because, you know, that depends on one's own thought, the way one is thinking and so on. But philosophically speaking, everything happens because of either perceptions or holding extreme views. In that way, Buddha said.
Thank you, Bhante.
Okay. I think no more questions, right? We will wind up.
Any more? Last question? I think no more, Bhante.
Okay. Then today's Dhamma sharing, I just wanted to show you something like, you know, the informative way. That is why I created this slideshow, rather than talking something general. I just want you to give insight with facts according to the Buddha's teachings and some elaborating certain suttas. That is not for just listening, but for thinking even after being home, right? Then you can collect these slides also. I have given them to the office here. So that elaborating on those points and think much about that, and then you can have more understanding on how to overcome anger, right? So in today's Dhamma sharing, we tried to discuss about how to overcome anger and what is anger and how being anger is harmful to oneself physically and psychologically. And also we were discussing on the causes for anger in different dimensions, right? Diverse ways why we are getting angry, why we corrupt our mind with angry thoughts and the reasons for that, and how to analyze the angry consciousness in such situations, and how to neglect them, right? Useless ways how to neglect them, and the way that angry is leading to the conflicts and some other higher status, and finally we were identified what are the strategies that can be carried out so that overcoming anger. So these are the points that we were discussing during the today's Dhamma sharing. I hope that you understood and you got something about how to control one's own mind and to maintain very peaceful mindset, and which will be helpful for you to maintain a very pleasant moment, and also how to be free from, how to make our life in very free from all these things, and how to maintain a good life in samsaric existence, right? So just try to think all these things, right? Always try to be very happy, maintain smile in your face, don't stay like very serious, right? So that smile can make you more happy, and not only you but also others, right? So that is very important wherever you are, even at the family house or wherever. Don't be silent and don't be like so serious. Just try to be friendly with others, and also try to maintain a smile with your face, which has been received by, because of your, you know, the smile has a kind of divine gift that we have received, right? If your face is beautiful, pretty, if you are not smile at others, that is something like, you know, puppet, just created, but it is not something live, right? So that can be done only by yourselves, right? We cannot do like by using a robot or whatever. Therefore, try to practice loving kindness, and then finally try to do good and try to be good, and try to maintain happiness always. Then you would be able to have a very successful life. So say sadhu 3 times. Sadhu. Okay, let us transfer merits to the departed ones, right? First of all, I would like to say thanks to the Mangala Vihara Buddhist Temple, the chief resident monk of the temple, Bhante Silananda, and also Bhante Sunita, for inviting me to be here when I am coming to TBA for the memorial Dhamma sermon of the Most Venerable Pathegama Jnanarama Thera. With that news, they invited me to conduct a Dhamma sermon here, and also the management committee members and the organizers, right? Thank you so much for doing everything and coordinating, and also all the participants. Today we have a very good crowd today, right? So many people that looks like you had a very eagerness of learning and the listening something about anger management also, right? That symbolizes how you are very interested in this topic and this Dhamma sharing. Thank you so much for coming today. And we'll share these merits that we accumulated to the departed ones, especially the chief, late chiefs, most venerable Mahavira Thera, and also the most venerable Jnanarama Thera, and the members of the Mahasangha who passed away, and those who contributed to this temple, so that building this temple into the current status, right? And also the family members, departed ones from your memory, from your name. May all the departed ones be free from suffering. Wherever they are, may their sansaric life be successful, prosper, and may they be able to attain the supreme bliss of Nibbana. Say sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Let us share these merits with the deities and divinities, or the may all the divinities, deities, may they have their life very successful, and may they have a joyful in their divine status. May all the divinities protect us, protect our family, our children, and all our nearest and dearest people, our country. May all the divine beings be well and happy. May they attain the supreme bliss of Nibbana. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Finally, with the merit that we accumulated by listening Dhamma, or the discussing Dhamma, teaching Dhamma, through that, the merits that we accumulated with the power of that merit, as well as the power of the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha, the great qualities of the Noble Triple Gem. May all of you have a good life, long life, and happy, peaceful coexistence in your life, and may you have a very joyful life in this life, and may you be able to attain the supreme bliss of Nibbana in your sansaric existence. Te sadhu. Akasattha ca bhummattha devanaga mahiddhika punyantang anumoditva chirang rakkantu loka sasanang. Akasattha ca bhummattha devanaga mahiddhika punyantang anumoditva chirang rakkantu loka sasanang. Akasattha ca bhummattha devanaga mahiddhika punyantang anumoditva chirang rakkantu loka sasanang. Abhivadana silissa nicchang uddapachayino chattaro dhamma vaddanti ayuvanno sukang balang ayurarogya sampatti sagga sampatti mevacha ato nibbana sampatti iminate samijjatu sukhi hotu.